Welcome to the video. How is everybody out there coming in here from the cold to get supercharged with positivity? And I certainly have that. I met my future self last night in a dream. Paid me a visit. Wow. It's like, you talk about somebody who's happy and poised and healthy and confident. And just like, wow. I said, what happened to you? I said, I retired. What do you mean? He said, best decision I ever made. It's fabulous. I said, you're happy in your time? He says, absolutely love it. Retired from what? Well, retired from the world's problems. But how do you retire? How do you retire is the question. You retire by trading in all your problems for just one problem, a continuity problem. That's how you retire. And when you do that, then you're only focused on solving the continuity problem. And to solve the continuity problem, all we have to do is write spiritual practice, which is easy. And the results of that, the dawning of the vision of oneness comes upon you. Gently. Not abruptly. You're not going to just be absolutely slammed into this incredible realization. And, you know, gently. So I have reason to be very optimistic now, in spite of my external circumstances at this point seem to be, you know, the worst possible circumstances, really. But man's extremity is God's opportunity. And so seeing this future, my future self, seeing how I'm going to be in the future, it's just like, wow, it works. It's possible to retire. You see, we have an identity problem because we tried to destroy our identity. And the vision of oneness reminds us of what our identity really is. And then we realize we don't have an identity problem at all. And all this can be explained. I've explained it in past videos and will continue to explain it clearly. But the heart and soul of success is right spiritual practice, which is starting with the continuity problem, is declarations. You're not asking your projections to take the problem away from you. You're not saying projection idol that I call God or whatever, will you please look kindly upon me and stop torturing me so much. That's not it. Okay. Because projections have no will. They have no capacity to stop being what they are, a projection. They're functioning, so they can't do anything for you. Idols can't do anything for you except recommend more projection. Recommend eternal death is what they really recommend to you. So you don't do it that way. Instead, you declare and you say, I don't have an identity problem. I don't have any identity problem at all. I don't have an identity problem. I only have a continuity problem. Which means I'm afraid to set all my projections down, and I'm afraid to be through with projections entirely this instant. I'm afraid of that. So I have a continuity problem. So I need to work on this problem. I have a fear of dropping my projections. That's it. I don't have a projection problem. I have a continuity problem. You are not a beggar. Okay, don't be a beggar. I see so many people in the world, the mindset is that of a beggar. Like, please, God, stop torturing me so much. Please, you're giving me all this terrible suffering. Please don't, can you at least have mercy on me, you know? You're talking to idols, to projections. Everything that seems to be doing something to us is a projection. Our projection, not God. God does not project. God can give a blessing to our spirit, which is able to deal with projections, okay, which is the Holy Spirit. But God does not project. It's our projections. So we should not be beggars. We are not beggars. Do not beg. Do not beg. So It's, I'm not like saying, God, can you please help me out? I got this terrible problem now and all this stuff. I'm saying, no, I don't have those problems. I return those problems in. I'm turning the problems in. I don't have a work problem. I have a continuity problem. I'm making an exchange. I'm making a deal with the Holy Spirit. I'm accepting God's deal for me. This is the deal. You trade in your problems that projection give rise to you for the continuity problem, and then the Holy Spirit will show you how to resolve the continuity problem. That's the deal. So I don't have a retirement problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a work problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a projection problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an idolatry problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a future problem. I have a continuity problem. Declarations are the way to do it. Not begging. Not begging. The more you beg, the worse the projection problem gets. The more you fall into idolatry. The reason why we are continuing to be beggars is the continuity problem. We don't accept it or recognize that we have this problem. Because why? The idols don't tell us about it. The idols will never tell us about the continuity problem, which is why maybe you've been begging, a beggar your whole life, begging for help, 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 and you're unaware of the continuity problem. They don't tell you, because that's the end of projections, isn't it? See, we told our projections that they're separate from us. They have a separate identity, separate will. And so when we're saying, I only have a continuity problem, that's the end of the projections. And the projections say, you can't do that, you're going to annihilate me, you're going to kill me. So they don't want to tell you that. But they do not have a separate will. That's a lie. They don't have a separate will. So there is no annihilation. There's nothing to annihilate there. It just merely we stop projecting. We soften our projections up. That's not an annihilation. It's our own will recognizing that it is our will. It's just a recognition, not an annihilation. So, but we, because of the fear of an abrupt change of experiencing, we were afraid to stop bowing to these idols of our own projections. We're really worshiping ourselves when we're bowing to these idols. We're worshiping ourselves as something separate from God in doing that. So when we keep begging, we're weakening ourselves more and more and more and more. So now we turn it around and we're declaring that is not. That problem is not separate from the continuity problem. In fact, it's only there because of my continuity problem. It only appears to me because of my continuity problem. So let me just focus everything on the continuity issue and not on all these other problems. Our idols will never tell us that we have a continuity problem, which is why we're ignorant of it. If we keep begging to idols, they'll never tell you about the continuity problem. They only try to energize themselves and maintain their existence. They're greedy grabbers. Idols are greedy grabbers, okay? They'll tell you to go out and work for them, to be enslaved for them, to glorify them, to aggrandize them. That's what they'll tell you to do. Because you are their life, actually. Duping you is their life. The only way they're surviving is to deceive you. And keep deceiving you, and keep deceiving you, and ultimately they want your death. They want you dead eternally, because they feel threatened by you. All the idols you pray to feel very threatened by you. So they're not your friends at all. They're your enemies. They want you dead. Why? Because you have the power to stop projecting, these idols. We are the power. We are the will. We are spirit. And so the idols, they pretend to be our friends, but really they seek our death. There's no question about it. No question about that. And not only our death, but our eternal death. They want us dead forever so that we'll never be able to stop projecting. And so they think that that's the only way they can have life is if we're eternally dead. That's what projections and idols are all about. So we don't play that game with them anymore. We just say, I don't have an idle problem. No, I don't have an idle problem. I only have a continuity problem. Or you can say, I'm exchanging my idle problem for the continuity problem. I'm exchanging my begging problem for the continuity problem. I'm exchanging my death problem for the continuity problem. You see, why do we die? Why do we suffer? Because idols tell us to. That's their advice for us. That's their advice. And we follow their advice. Why? Out of fear of the continuity problem. That's why we're following their advice, actually. We're bringing all this stuff upon ourselves. So the medicine for the continuity problem is wonderful medicine. It's great medicine. It's the best medicine there is. And we get to take that medicine. Once we accept, yeah, I do have this continuity problem, then we'll take the medicine for it. Otherwise, we'll keep listening to idols, and idols will say, no, 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 you don't have a continuity problem. You got a work problem, or you got the money problem, or you got a health problem, or you got an aging problem, or you got this problem. That's what the idols will tell you. As long as you ask idols what your problem is, they'll never tell you that it's the continuity problem, that you have that option. Only the Holy Spirit will tell you that. So, anyone who's really accepts that they have a continuity problem, that means they've been listening to the Holy Spirit. Absolutely, that's what it means. And turning away from the advice of idols, turning away from that, recognizing what it is that idols are advising you. They're advising you to be annihilated, is what they're advising you. So, what do you think happens to a world that is listening to the advice of idols? Look at history. Look at history. If you really look at history, I don't really advise you to, but it's appalling. The history of this planet is absolutely appalling. We could get into that, but that's kind of a side trip. I mean, I could explain it, but that might lead us a little bit off track here. Let's just stick to the main theme, keep it simple, which is exchanging all problems that idols tell you have for just the one problem you really have, with a continuity problem, which means you're afraid to completely drop all projection. So, the vision of oneness shows us everything, everywhere we go, but there are still things, but everything seems to be, is centrally located in God. Everything is centrally located in God. There's no difference about their location in regard to God. Everything is centrally located in God. Right now, with our perception, nothing is centrally located in God. Everything has a gradation. Everything has levels. Okay, we have this vast judgment upon everything. Perception is a judgment. And we feel we're the center. And then everything in relation to this center is different, has a different relationship to this center. This is delusion. This causes a sense of a fear that our identity is vulnerable. That our identity is threatened. And we try to get things closer, precious things for us. But of course, others want those precious things too. And so they want to attack us and steal it from us. Everybody's greedy grabbing, greedy grabbers. Desperately trying to build a stable identity. Based on judgment, based on perception. The vision of oneness cures this. It cures it. Everything is seen in the immaculate center of the one everywhereness, the pure spaciousness, zero dimensionality. Everything is in zero dimensionality. Everything is in the immaculate center of that, forever. forever. It's the foreverness of it that is the key. It's not that you just see for a moment that everything is perfectly centered and then it's not, that it changes. No, it's forever that way. And so you can't really be happy unless you see your future is going to be happy. And when you see that everything is forever immaculately centered in the very heart of God, then you can be happy. Because you realize every identity is safe, it's stable, it's perfect, it's flawless. There's no threat to identity whatsoever. Because here, it's not enough we think, I got all these jewels and riches. If somebody else over there doesn't have it, then that threatens our identity. It does threaten our identity. Which is why you see these very rich people. They're still very, you can see they're paranoid, they're worried, they're frightened. They're not stable at all. Because I say, that's that one over there, they don't have all this stuff. They're going to come after me and try to get it. You know, they're suffering, they're sick, they're angry, you know. It's not stable identity. Perception doesn't show you stable identity. Only the vision of oneness shows you stable identity, shows us that. And then it's like, oh, wow, identity is not under any threat at all. Then you don't have to be a greedy grabber working for idols to say, how do I get that? How do I get that? How do I get all that money? How do I get all this stuff? How do I possess it forever? How can I possess it forever? Then you think, my gosh, my body's dying. I won't be able to hold on to it forever. And then that's another, you know, drives you crazy. You look at these super rich people. You hear these stories of the heirs and heiresses. And you know, they're spending the last 30, they've become recluses, spend the last 40 years of their life in a hospital bed, all sorts of mental problems and suffering. And, you know, it's just, you know, horrible, horrible for them. It doesn't work. That doesn't work. So, in seeing my future self, paid me a visit in my dream. Now, what was the activity, the shakti of my future self? I was shown, this is the Mrs. future self. Like, in other words, what's called the feminine side or the shakti side, which is engagement with the world. Okay, the feminine side, the feminine energy is this engagement with the world, whereas the masculine side is the vision of oneness, the abstract experiencing of the oneness. But because we're in this world, we have this feminine side, which is engagement with the world. So I also met that feminine side, future feminine side too. And I said, what do you do? Or I asked my future male side, what does she do? She works with severely depressed people on a crisis hotline or something. The volunteers for suicidally depressed people. She counsels them. I said, wow, that's amazing. And then I asked her, I said, do you like your job? She goes, oh, yeah, I love it. I said, well, does it bother you? You get these desperate people. Doesn't that cause you a lot of stress? She goes, no, not at all. I said, you're not troubled by that? No. I mean, this isn't the intensity of the situation. I mean, you're dealing with all these super depressed people. That doesn't make you depressed now? She goes, no, not in the slightest. I said, wow. I also said, you know, I'm not sure if she likes me, really. Why? Very impersonal. Very impersonal. We're used to the feminine side having judgment, being judgmental, and say, I want to engage with this person. I like them, and I don't like them so much because that's from perception. But this feminine shakti side of my future self was impersonal. Did not have that. So I said, I don't really think she likes me, you know, in particular. That's because it's completely impersonal. Wasn't bothered by working with these suicidally depressed people. Totally stable identity, you know. No specialness. This is the high, this is the true realization. So that looks like my future self. That for sure. Well, the truth is that everybody in this world is suicidally depressed. That is because we're desperately trying to fend it off. But it keeps breaking through, you know, it keeps breaking through. Because following the vice of idols leads to suicidal depression. And that's all we're doing is following the vice of idols. It's just that we are, you know, we keep trying to frantically get enough energy to follow the idols' advice. And what do? They suck all the energy out of us. You know, the ego says that we live in this superior kingdom to reality, where truth and lies are compatible. That's its belief. But what really is going on here is oscillation between truth and lies. They're not compatible. It's oscillation. So the idol's advice to us is oscillate. And this oscillation burns us out. It burns form out. It creates friction and heat and confusion and severe depression, suicidal depression. The more we're engaged in this oscillation, like an engine, like that. It's oscillation, the piston, like that. We're oscillating between truth and lies. And the ego claims that that's compatibility. It's not compatibility. That just produces force. Oscillation is this, you know, mechanical force. Everything that we see is this pressure system of oscillation. That is not compatibility. It's oscillation. So the ego's lying to us, saying it's compatible. It's oscillation. And that burns us out. That's why we get sick. That's why we have all these troubles. In the vision of oneness, there's no oscillation, none of that. We're not trying to make both truth and lies true. We're realizing only truth is true. The ego claims, again, that the ego has found a secret where both truth and lies are totally compatible. But what it's really selling to us is this terrible oscillation. And so we're all caught in this oscillation, and we're all suicidally depressed, really. No question about it. And, you know, my previous life, I was so successful. Everybody thought I was indestructible. And you know, the paragon of success and happiness. But I have this life now. What happens? I fall into this terrible suicidal depression. I mean, the people who knew me previously saw this life, they would be incredulous, completely incredulous. They thought I had this spirit that was indestructible. And here I am in the very pits of suicidal depression, you see. So it catches up with you. It catches up. Because you run out of energy. You run out of energy. You keep stimulating yourself to keep feeding the idols beautiful oscillation. Beautiful oscillation. The idols say, we need more beautiful oscillation because people are getting tired of it. And you run out of energy and you collapse. And you don't, and your mind goes faster and faster, and you oscillate more and more and more. It just burns, it drains you of all energy. That's what happened to me. And then you become suicidally depressed. You say, I don't have any more energy. I can't serve these idols anymore. I can't do what they want. Again, let me share this with you. What idols want is your death. Okay? And they pursue your death through this oscillation. They think if they can just oscillate fast enough, you will die eternally. So they're really promoting eternal death with all this oscillation. But they sugarcoat and package it in beautiful, beautiful ways, trying to keep you, string you along like this. So, in following the advice of idols, I ended up in this condition that felt like eternal death, actually. That's what it felt like. Which was really total confusion, total chaos. It felt like eternal death. And I said, wow, you know, I don't want to keep on experiencing that. No way. And that's when I turned away from idols and turned to the Holy Spirit, 1978. And from that time on, I've been now re-educated, turned around, and it's been explained to me what's really taking place in the world. So everybody here is on the iceberg of suicidal depression. It's on the ice floe. It's melting. It's melting. It's like you're on this ice floe. And you're drifting in the ocean, an ice cold ocean. And you're busy building an igloo, you know, and hunting for blubber and various things. And you're so busy, you know, but all the while it's melting, it's melting. And one day you look around and you're just on this little tiny, and you start to sink into the ocean, the cold ocean. There's no more ice left. And you're just like, oh my gosh, know, and that's when it hits you. You know, I'm in big trouble. What do? You warm the ocean up. When you're sinking to the ocean, you warm the ocean up. That's what you really do. Or, another way to put it, you become buoyant. Become very buoyant. Begin to float. You yourself begin to float. Let's put it that way. You're on this ice floe. It's all melting. You're ready to go into this ice cold ocean. You feel it, and you're drained of all energy, like you got hypothermia. I actually had the experience of hypothermia to the utmost extent about at that time, about in maybe 1977, just before I had the turnaround, I think. Yeah, 74, 75, maybe 76, or 1976 or 1977. I believe it was then, or maybe 70, 75, but I had this experience. And all the energy was taken out of me entirely. And I couldn't even move. All I could do was shake. I couldn't talk. I couldn't move. I couldn't do anything. Extreme hypothermia. Got stuck up in the snow. It gets you. And that was that's what idols want. They suck all the energy out of you. They suck all the life out of you. They want you completely dead, so you cannot remove end your projection. You see, they are projections. My uncle, super healthy guy. Everybody thought he would live forever. And wonderful guy, best person I've ever met in my life on this planet. He is very healthy. He's getting older, in his 80s, and he took a hike every morning up in the mountains. So by himself. So he took this hike one morning up in the mountains, and a freak thunderstorm came in, and it suddenly became extremely cold. This was in the desert, so it's usually quite, well, in the morning it's pretty cool. But this thunderstorm came in, and it absolutely soaked him. There was nowhere to hide from the rain. He got completely soaked with this really cold rain, and that street wind came up, and he was too far away from his house. And by the time he got back to his home, he was suffering from severe hypothermia. He barely made it back to his house, and he had no heat in his house. And he couldn't talk, and he couldn't function. He couldn't call anybody on the telephone, you see, because his coordination was all gone. I know, I've been through it. You lose all your coordination. So he just took a morning hike, healthy as can be, freak thunderstorm, got soaked, began all his energy and heat got drained out of his body. He began to suffer from hypothermia. He couldn't call, and he stayed in that state in his house for 2 days, suffering with no heat, and he couldn't call anybody. He lived it, and he didn't have heat in his house. And there wasn't any near neighbors really around him, you know. So somebody came in and checked on him or something. I hadn't seen him for a while, checked on him and found him there. And they called the hospital because he seemed to be in a terrible state, right? It was all like frozen up and shaking and couldn't talk. They said, oh my gosh. So what's happened to him? What's happened? So I was scared to heck. They called the hospital, the ambulance came out, picked him up, okay? He couldn't talk. Nobody knew what happened. They brought him to the emergency, and he saw this intern doctor, some young intern doctor. This doctor diagnosed him with Alzheimer's, severe advanced Alzheimer's disease, and put him on this very strong medicine called Aricept, I think, something like that. Put him on this antipsychotic Alzheimer's medication. Now, he'd never taken any medication in his whole life. He was a health nut, super healthy guy, brilliant, genius, photographic memory, just an incredible person. They put him on this antipsychotic Alzheimer medicine, and that caused then a full-blown psychosis in him. The medicine had a terrible effect on him. And then they transferred him into a assisted living lockdown facility for severe Alzheimer's patients, okay? Nobody knew, his relatives knew what was going on. Nobody knew. I didn't even know what was going on. I get a call one day and say, your uncle is in this facility suffering from severe Alzheimer's. And I said, what? What are you talking about? So I immediately went down, you know, to see him. And it turned into this incredible saga of, you see, he was under orders to take this medication. And it was keeping him sick. He had recovered from the hypothermia. And so finally, we were able to get him off the medication. It was an incredibly difficult thing to do. And he recovered, of course, and he was fine. His mentally, everything was fine. But the ordeal did leave him unglued at some level. It was just the most horrifying experience for him imaginable. This is somebody who never went to doctors, never took medicine, his whole belief system, you know, he is healthy eating food, and suddenly he finds himself in a locked facility that he can't leave, being fed this terrible food and having all these medications shoved down his throat, forced, you know, terrible poisonous medications for him. All because one morning he went out and took a walk. That is a true story, and he never really recovered from it. And I tried my utmost to help him out. And eventually he choked on some, they had to grind up food, pureed food for him. He couldn't function as well as before. He got food down his esophagus, his breathing, his lungs, in eating one morning. And they rushed him to the hospital and he died from just eating this ground up gruel that got into his lungs. Tragic. And again, this was people who met him. I was looking at his pictures a couple days ago. The most humorous, the most natural comedic person you'll ever meet. Just you look at him and you just start laughing. He had this wonderful, humorous disposition and gentleness and kindness. He was just the most super person you could ever meet, you know. And we miss him to this day. You never replace someone like that. He just took a hike one morning, okay? That is a true story, shocking story. All the energy was suddenly sucked out of him, and then the idol said, give him this medication, lock him up, he's mentally ill, severely mentally ill, and nobody would believe that he wasn't. Nobody would believe he wasn't, except he did get some help. He did get some help from one person, actually. This is what happens. Now, the problem was, with him, is he tried to, he followed the advice of idols, as we all do, and he tried to beautify the idols. Okay, he was genius at music, genius at song, a genius at humor, a genius at being able to produce an atmosphere, a rare, high cultural atmosphere. This is what the idols want, because that camouflages what they're really about. So I could not get that through to him. I couldn't get it through to him. That said, hey, you know, you don't understand what's really going on. He thought he did. He thought he was really very, very wise about spiritual matters, but he wasn't. He was a genius at that too, at least superficially, as some people are, but he didn't really understand it, and I couldn't quite explain it to him properly. At that time, I wasn't clear enough to explain it to him. So idols have their way, okay? They have their way. As again, I got led into a freak storm too and had severe hypothermia and was saved by someone. And that's very sobering. Once you go through that, it changes your life. Because you're still alive, and you're still mentally everything. Just a moment ago, you know, hours ago, you were like your total normal self, and now you're helpless. You can't move, you can't talk, you don't have control of your muscles or your speech, and you're like a dead person, except you're still alive. It's horrible. Hypothermia is horrible, horrible experience. And that really sobers you up. And again, I was, the idols drain you of all energy. And doctors and psychiatrists and everything else, they say you have a depression problem. You have an energy problem, really. You have an oscillation problem. You see, you've been trying to oscillate too much, too fast, and you burn out. You have a burnout problem. You have a stress problem. You're burned out is the real fact of the matter. And you don't know how to regain. So I went decades and decades of feeling like I had zero energy, total burnout. I suffered from total burnout. And the idols, of course, kept demanding more from me, more. Produce songs for me, glorify me, go out and get me beautiful clothes, the idols keep demanding more and more and more from you. They're unconscionable, okay? They want your death, they want your eternal death, but before you do that, they want to suck all the life out of you to glorify themselves. And that is what we worship. That is what we worship in this world, really. We don't realize it, because we're trying to empower them. Because why? We're trying to be greater than God. And that is how we're doing it. We're trying to prove that we're greater than God. That there's some will that is greater than God's. We're trying to prove there's some will that's greater than God's. But the result of that is, which we actually end up pursuing our eternal death. But remember, projections are our own will. They're not separate from our own will. And our will is actually one with God. All right? But by projecting our will, thinking there's some external will to ours, we think there's some will greater than God. Because again, it seems that these idols have greater will than us. And so we know that our will is one with God. So if the idols have greater will than us, they also have greater will than God. You see? So we're like proving this, that we're experiencing. We think we're experiencing a transformation, from God's will to a new will that is greater than God's. But really, these idols hate us. You see, that's the secret we don't realize. They feel totally threatened by us. We think that they're on our side. No, they're not. They want to destroy us so they can live, because they think that we have the power to remove the projection, remove their life, their functioning from them, which we do. We do. And we can't get rid of that. It's impossible to get rid of that. So eventually we have to realize that we have to turn against the idols and say, no, I can't get rid of this will. I can't get rid of my life. I'll just be eternally tortured by you. That's the far as you can ever go. I experienced that. You cannot suffer eternal death. You can only suffer total chaos. That's as far as you can go. And that's, you cannot abide in total chaos. You cannot. So there's no road to go on except to turn around and take your power back from idols and stop worshiping them. And turn towards the vision, turn to the Holy Spirit and turn to the vision of oneness. You don't have any option. We don't have any other option. That is a fact. So the options are set for us already. It's just a matter of how much time we take to realize this and finally accept the vision of oneness. Accept that I have a continuity problem is the first step. The mood of repentance. I repent. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an idol problem anymore. No. I'm exchanging my problem with idols for the continuity problem. Make the exchange with the Holy Spirit. That's what it's there for. And the Holy Spirit will then take all the problems of the idols, and it will deal with those for you. You know, work, life, food, security, everything. If you just focus on the continuity problem and right spiritual exercises. And my experience with idols is they take everything from you. They suck you, bleed you dry, and then try to squeeze even more blood out of you. They want all your efforts to aggrandize them and glorify them. And then you end up nothing. That is true. Because they hate you. Your idols, our idols hate us. They want us eternally dead. Because we have the power again to end projection. And they know it. They know it. They may, when you go pray and vow and beg for them, they may seem benevolent to you. But inside, they have the utmost dread for you and the utmost hatred. You're their total enemy, actually. And so the advice they give you is, before you die eternally, give me all your power. Give me all your glory. Give me all your beauty. Give me all this stuff. You know, take it all away from you. Greedy grabbers. Idols are greedy grabbers. And then once you've given them everything you've got, they'll leave you in the gutter to die. That's a fact. That is a fact. Oh, they'll tell you to overdose or something, right? They'll tell you, go kill yourself, basically, is what they'll tell you. Absolutely. This is gospel fact, I'm telling you. I've lived through the whole thing. It's exactly what happens. So, suicidally depressed people, I understand what they're going through. And I got helped by those who understood perfectly, perfectly competent teachers who understood exactly what's going on. And of course, the idols, seeing that I was getting free, put on a desperate last push for me to serve them and give them everything I got, which I did. But then I started getting wise to the whole situation. I said, oh, wait a minute. I'm not getting anything out of this. What's going on? You promise. The idols always promise you. Promise, promise, promise. The idols say, give me all your money and I'll give it back tenfold. So, okay, you do that. You don't get a penny back. Everything, all the money and effort I gave the idols, I never got a penny back. Nothing. They took it all for themselves. And looked at me and says, who are you? You know, I don't even know you. You're nothing. You're a thief. You're asking me for something back? No, you're a criminal. Go kill yourself. You know, that's what they said. Totally greedy. Greedy grabbers. Of course, the idols insist that they're your god, that they're only here to make you happy and stuff. It's not true. They're only here to try and kill you and make sure you stay dead. That's what idols literally are all about. So be happy that you can turn to the Holy Spirit that saves you from idols. Thank you, God. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for saving me from idols. And, you know, I'm still suffering from the effect of idols, for sure. My future self, I could tell, was cured of the idolatry problem. Cured, no question about it. There's no question about it. This was not somebody who'd had all their life sucked out of them, okay? The feminine part, the missus part, had not sucked all the life and energy and happiness out of this future self. The masculine part that I saw, no. No, he was genuinely radiant with health. So it was a proper situation. That means cured of idolatry, cured of turning to idols. It means experiencing a vision of oneness and no longer trying to give your energy away to idols. So I was cured. I was cured. And then the Shakti part, the active energy part that engages people in the world, was spending time counseling, you know, suicidally depressed people, which is actually everybody. You know, those who are like for me, I was so bad, all the doctors said, there's nothing we can do for you. Sorry, you're beyond our help. That's when I got the counseling from these super competent teachers who explained to me what's really going on. So that's the right counseling. Now, when I say counseling suicidally depressed people, I mean those who literally are at the point where they need the counseling. They need to be hear the truth. All right. Those are the ones that are going to get who are going to recover. Those are the ones who are going to recover. So I was just doing that, which is what I want to do. Of course, once you go through this, you know how terrible it is, and you know that there is an answer. So of course you're going to share that and help out those who are really need it. The drugs stop working, you know, none of the drugs work, and they're just like, you know, living cadavers. I mean, what I always felt like I was just a walking dead person for a long, long time. I was in the world, but I felt completely dead. I had no life, no energy, nothing. But I was still alive, still breathing. I said, how am I still breathing? I feel completely dead. That's what idols lead you to. And it wasn't just this lifetime, it was previous lifetimes. Idols have been moving me in that direction, trying to get everything possible out of me, and then pushing me into eternal death is what they did. They pushed me into total mental chaos. But then I realized that's as far as you can go. There is no eternal death. We cannot die, but we can experience total chaos, which feels like it can go on forever because there's no reference point. See, they don't see any way to get out of it, so it feels like forever. And then I realized that's as far as you can go. And you just don't want to be stuck with this forever? I said, no way, no way. And every single person who experiences that will say, no way, forget it, that's it. And at that point, I turned against idols. And I turned my will against idols. And I said, no, you know, no. You are liars. You are deceivers. And I'm going to free myself from you. At that very point, that was the turnaround. And I said, it's only a matter of time that I am going to take your power away over me, for sure. Now, it's taken me a long time, for sure. But the Holy Spirit told me at that point, says, you're going to get well, but it's going to take you a while. But all it's just going to be, you know, work. You're going to have to work at it, hard work, but you're good at that. So don't worry about it. You'll succeed. Because I was a workaholic. Of course, when you serve idols, you're a workaholic. The more you serve them, the more workaholic you are. And the more you take, you know, caffeine and drugs, whatever it takes, sex, drugs, rock and roll, whatever you need to keep this workaholicness, you know. Like these workaholics, like their CEOs and stuff, I mean, my God, if you really knew their private lives, they do everything they can to keep stimulating themselves, to remain, you know, just a tremendous workaholic. They're serving idols, that's why. So, Holy Spirit said, well, you're already a workaholic, don't worry. You got the work ethic, you just have to work at it. So that's what I've done. And gradually, bit by bit, diminish the hold that idols have upon me, you know, upon my will. And that's the same path everybody has to take. That's the same for everybody in that regard. The direction is the same for everybody. All the details are unique to everyone, but the direction is exactly the same for everybody. You're going towards the vision of oneness, for sure. Going away from idolatry, for sure. Recognizing that they're all just your own projections, for sure. That is the direction you're going to. Turning over all your problems to the Holy Spirit, that's the direction you're going in, for sure. Once you have that turnaround, once you hit the bottom, once you find out what idols want for you, which is eternal death. Of course, when we want to be greater than God, what we're actually desiring is our eternal death. That's exactly what we're desiring. And we end up, like in my case, you end up experiencing it, and you find out it's total chaos. I say, whoops, don't want that. Okay, that's a bad idea. I mean, that's what I thought. I said, wow, that was a bad idea. This is the end result of this idea of wanting to be greater than God. Total chaos. I said, okay, don't want that. I'm finished with that. But what do I do? At that point, I said, oh my God, now I got a continuity problem, right? At that point, I said, uh-oh. I'm finished with this. I don't want this idea anymore. But I got a continuity problem because I'm totally used to all, you know, everything that I've been doing. Projection and, you know, I'm told, what do I do? I got a continuity problem. Right spiritual practice. Right spiritual practice, bit by bit by bit. Right spiritual practice. So I can say there's never been any abruptness on my path at all as far as getting free of all this. No, no, none. Very gentle, very smooth, just bit by bit by bit. It's like the tortoise just, you know, slowly moving along. That's the Holy Spirit for you. That's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit doesn't have anything to prove. It's not an idol. It's not demanding your death. It can be gentle and kind and with you, you know. It's not trying to impress you with anything. It's just helping you along as fast as you can go, but without causing you to backslide out of fear. We're so used to working on problems, right? The problems that idols have, that we're afraid, what do I do without problems? So we keep some problems. The Holy Spirit lets us keep some problems, but leading us towards the continuity problem is the only problem. And then the vision of oneness is the medicine for that problem. So we're supposed to just abide in the vision of oneness as medicine. It's our medicine we gotta take. But of course that makes us tremendously happy and peaceful. But it's medicine we have to take, so. Look at it that way. Look at it that way. And then you'll be calm about it. You'll be calm. You won't say, hey, everybody, I'm enlightened. You wouldn't believe what experience I'm having. Wow, da-da. No, you just, it's a calmness. I mean, my future self was calm, okay? I experienced that this morning in a dream. Calm, very calm. Was not some ecstatic wild man, absolutely not. Was very calm, very peaceful, very happy, very serene, very poised. Because so understanding this vision of oneness is medicine for to cure the severe problem. Medicine to cure the severe problem. Just taking the medicine. So humble too, still humble. I didn't feel like he's saying, look how great I am, you know, or something. No. And interacting with me in a very friendly, very humble manner, very friendly, you know, very approachable. Not on some spiritual ego trip or anything, no way. So the vision of oneness comes to you. Just be grateful, just grateful. Just have gratitude and just calmly abide in that with gratitude, understanding what it's about, that it's curing this problem we have with perception and feeling of a loss of identity and then therefore worshiping idols and all of that. It's curing the root of it, which is you're experiencing non-localized identity, which is not localized anywhere. It's localized everywhere equally. Everything is in the immaculate heart of God. Just experiencing that, and you just have gratitude for that. But it's you're in therapy, so you're taking the medicine, so you remain humble. Serious, humble, you remain in that to the best of your capacity. Because I'm telling you, severely suicidally depressed people are very frightened by the wild man syndrome, or wild Shakti, you know, very much frightened. That's not how to reach them. Their own mind is so caught up in severe oscillation that their own experiencing is so wild. I mean, the experiencing I went through was so intense, you cannot even describe how intense it was. The intensity was so insane, so severe, that I was like just watching it and amazed, you know. And so it kept me alive. I was so amazed at this wild intensity of the mind, frantically, you know, going, trying to go everywhere at once, oscillating everywhere at once, trying to get everywhere at once. Right? That's the idol's advice. Whereas the vision of oneness, you don't have to go anywhere. Everything just as it is, without any motion whatsoever, is perfectly centered, immaculately centered forever in the very heart of God. So you don't have to go anywhere or do anything for that to be so. So your whole mind, everything calms down and is peaceful and poised and relaxed. So these people who are in this the intensity of depression is just wild intensity. And you're exhausted. You look like you're no intensity. You're so tired and exhausted. You're just like sitting there like this, just dead. But the intensity of your mind is just like unbelievable what's going on. They don't want to see some wild person screaming about, yeah, God is one, oh my God. You know, that scares the heck out of them. And conversely, they also are a little frightened by someone who's just completely silent, you know, like Ramana Maharshi. I remember I was a little scared by that because that's so different than this wild intensity I was experiencing, right? So we want some activity taking place, some. A little bit, okay, is okay. The Shakti has a little bit of play to it, pragmatically. You're not just a complete stone. It's a little frightening. But you don't want to overdo it with the wild man act. The crazy wisdom wild man act, you know. That's very intimidating to those who are suicidally depressed, for sure. Very intimidating. I think the genteel life is what I saw, is what helped me. Just go out and play golf. You know, it's just sort of a cool, very peaceful, mellow, non-wild man thing, very stable. Just go out and play some golf. So there's just some activity, very conservative. You know, there's no wild parties, there's no wildness. So that is the way that I see, is the way that works. The other stuff, the wild man act, in my opinion, is serving idols, okay? And it's, the wild man is like the empowerment of the idol to suck all the money and energy and blood out of all the devotees for the purpose of idolatry, then leaving them all in a suicidal, depressed state. That's what I see happening with these fake gurus, these wild man gurus, etc. The wild Shakti. It's really the Shakti, it's the feminine aspect of them. That is the wild aspect, because that's the part that interacts with the world. And the male aspect is just the glib presence type of thing that has the talk, you know, with the talk. But the walk is the Shakti, the feminine aspect. And that when that gets wild, it's sucking all the energy and money and life out of all the devotees for the purpose of idolatry. That's what I've seen. I experienced that too. Unfortunately, I was saved from it. That would have killed me for sure. Almost got into the clutches of this wild man, wild Shakti, you know, false guru thing that was sucking the energy out of so many people. Was saved by it, saved from it somehow. I was told by the Holy Spirit, stay away from that. That's your ruination. And I trusted it, you know, trusted the Holy Spirit saying no. But the shocked he still got me in some other way. You know, if it doesn't get you in the wild man way, it'll get you in the beautiful woman way or something like that, you know, the glamorous. She pretends that she's the opposite of the wild man, you know. So it gets you one way or the other, and you think, wow, oh yeah, she's not the wild man. But then she says she wants more and more beautiful clothes, more and more beautiful homes, more and more beautiful this, more and more beautiful this. You know, and it sucks the energy out of you that way, all the while appearing to be so demure, you know, and that kind of thing. And but an inner circle, totally demanding, totally greedy grabber type of thing. It's just the flip side of idolatry, how we get, you know, tricked by our idols, our projections. But, you know, saw through that one too. So, serene, more serenity. You know, there's a way, that there's a balance where you're not doing either one of those, really. Where there needs to be some intensity, otherwise it frightens us because we're so used to intensity. But it's got to be a smoothed out intensity, otherwise we get terrified by, because we're so scared of this intensity that this oscillation brings us. It's like I felt like I was helpless in the jaws of this incredible mental intensity that was just sucking all the life out of me, and I couldn't do anything about it. I couldn't stop it. Couldn't stop the mind, the oscillation, couldn't stop it. I was helpless, felt helpless. So we're terrified of that. We're terrified of too much intensity, but we're also very scared of not having any intensity, right? So it's a fine line, really, that has to be walked. I was told, just go out and play golf. Just get out there, very peaceful, like a beautiful garden, just walk, you know, and just... So golf gives you a little bit of intensity, but not a lot. But just enough to feel like you're doing something, like you're recreating, like you're moving, you know, just enough. But it's also very peaceful. You feel like like sitting there not doing anything. Just like taking it easy. But you still have a little, you know, you're still, you know, like the world says, you gotta go out there and recreate, you know, do stuff, you know, get out in nature, all this stuff. You're still doing that. There's some intensity, but very mellow too. And that's all that's happening. That's all that's happening. And you can dress up in clown-like clothes and stuff. So you have a little bit of dress-up going on, which, again, you're a little afraid of just wearing some, you know, a hair shirt, sackcloth or something. So you can go out and you can put on your bright clothes on the golf course for a little while. But you're not really interacting with anybody that way. You know, it's not like you're some party where everybody, you know, some nightclub with all the dreadful sleaziness of all that stuff. But you can still put on a little bit of Ritz, you know, on your clothing. Feel like you're, you know, doing that. So there's a little tinge of worldliness to it, but there's also the tinge of otherworldliness to it, of vision of oneness to it, peacefulness, oneness to it. It's both there. So that's what I did. That's what I did. That's what I was told to do. And of course, on a golf course, you're very polite, very good manners, very kind to one another. You practice this appreciation for others, not getting in their way, right manners. You treat people very well on the golf course when you meet them. You know, it's very, very much that way. The conversation doesn't get into wicked, terrible stuff. You know, it's you're just here for the peace, and everyone understands. Just give everyone their own space. You give everyone their own space on a golf course. You don't play head trips or mind trips or mind games with them. No. You're there for your therapy. They're there for their therapy. And you let that be. You know, that's what I discovered. People are out there for therapy. And you let them have it. You let them have their therapy. You know, you praise them. Good shot. Nice. Well done, well done. It's like that. You're supportive of one another, very supportive. So it's a very good therapeutic situation, actually. It's worked for me. But you see, the wild man has the long hair and the beads and all this kind of stuff, you know. And like for me, my future self, very conservative. Short haircut, conservative clothing like I'm wearing now. Looked like a very solid conservative citizen. You know, no wild man act at all there. No. And that's what I want. That's the way. That's the way. The other stuff, no, been there, done that, seen that. Whew. Now, the experience of my teachers have been also very conservative, like Longchenpa, Longchenpa visited me, very conservative looking. There was no wild man act there at all. No wild man act, no. Same with Jesus, no wild man act taking place there. No crazy wisdom act, no. Absolutely not. Just peaceful, very peaceful, very serene, very calm, very competent, very confident. They give you an aura of competency. That's it. They don't need to be doing any crazy wisdom, wild man act, or wild woman act, really. It's really the feminine. It's the feminine Shakti that's doing the act, actually. They don't need to. They know they're totally competent. And they just radiate this competency to you. And that's what you pick up on. You say, wow, this person, this one is very confident and competent. They're not need to put on any act at all. They're certain. They have this very, very clear certainty about them, you know, and that just impresses your spirit greatly. So you can tell when there's a super competency. You can tell. You can tell. So that's how I saw my future self. I saw my future self. I said, wow, great guy. You know, it's like very approachable, very friendly, very competent, very happy. In a very good position. So it's tremendous, tremendous. So those who are suicidally depressed, take heart, you know, take heart, which is all of us, but those who realize what the idols actually are up to, that they want your eternal death, which is very frightening. Let's not sugarcoat it. I mean, what I experienced was extremely frightening, because I realized those who I've been serving all this time wanted my eternal death. That's what they're really after. So that's very frightening. It's not fun at all, really. It's too wild. It's really too wild. That is for sure. So the adventure gets too wild. You say, no. No, this is too much. Too scary. Competency, there exists. There are those who are truly competent, super competent. The Holy Spirit's totally competent, immaculately competent. All of that is there. There's no question about it. It's all there. It all is there, and they know who needs help, who's willing to be helped. And all of that is known. And you get the help. You get the help. No matter how you're tricked or how you fall, they know the way. They know the way. They know the direction you need to go in. It's just a matter of going in that direction. That's it. So. I know that those are in the grip of this wild oscillation. They feel that there's just no way they can be safe, no way. But you can, absolutely you can. Because you can lessen, as you work on your continuity problem, you begin to take your will back from your idols, from your projections. You begin to project less. And as you do that, the intimidation that the idols put on you, the demands, you're able to stand up to them and just say, no, I don't think I'm going to do that. You're like, huh? You're like, you're very surprised. What? What did I just do? I just said no to these idols. It's like, huh? How'd I do that? It's amazing. It amazes you. Like, are you kidding me? I never could do that before. That's what the path is. The path is very interesting. It's very amazing because you continually amaze yourself. You say, how did I stand up to these idols like that? And this is amazing. And you feel very proud of yourself, like, this is great. I just did something I didn't think I could ever do. So the path is actually very, very interesting. And that's what keeps you going. Because you say, maybe tomorrow I might stand up to the idols even more. And so you don't die. You say, no, I'm going to live one more day. Take it a day at a time. Just one day at a time is how I did it. So I said, I'm going to live one more day and see what happens. I'm still there. I'm still there saying I'm going to take it one more day and see what happens. Because I'm still on the path idols have made for me has no future. You know, they took everything from me. So it doesn't seem like I have any future at all. But I'm going to say I'm going to take it just one more day. See what happens. So the Holy Spirit will restore your life to you, the one that the idols tried to take away from you. So how that is restored to me, I don't know, but it's going to be restored to me. I saw my future self. I saw it obviously life had been restored to me. There's no question about it. So again, even though you feel there's no way you can be cured, take one day at a time and you will find some success in that day. You will find in some little way you said no to your idol's advice. No, I'm not going to follow that advice. That's wrong advice. I'm not going to do that. Little bit, you know, just timidly, no. Bit by bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, you begin to turn the tables on the idols. And you stop following their advice, bit by bit by bit, just a little bit by bit. You can't do it just all at once from the standpoint of a severe depression and just say completely no to all that, because you got the continuity problem there. Okay, it prevents you from doing that. But that's okay. You just do it bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. Every day you say, I'm interested in what happens today. That's all I've done. Today I'm interested in what happens. At the end of the day, I said, wow, made a lot of progress. And you wake up in the morning, you think, oh, but I'm still suffering terrible. And then you have to say, well, let me just see what happens this day. Let me just try my best today. That's all you can do. That's all you can do. But that works. That works. That works. So that's all I'm going to do. Rest of the day, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't have any more work, actually. I finished all my projects. There's virtually nothing for me to do to be paid. And, you know, to get money, to pay bills, there's nothing more I can do. And so it's like, wow, okay, let me just take it a day at a time. See what happens. So very cool that my future self showed up to me back in time where I am now and visited me and showed me what I'm going to be like in the future. This is one happy person, I'm telling you that. This is one, you know, just obviously great circumstances, obviously living in very good circumstances. I asked him, how is it, you know? It's just, how is it being retired? I mean, retired from idols, retired from idolatry, really, is what he's talking about. He said, I'm retired. And he says, the best decision I ever made, meaning retired from idolatry. And I said, I wanted to know, how is it? He says, fantastic. I love it. I love it. My life is just tremendous. Just tremendous. He wasn't some beggar in rags, you know, either. No. Well-dressed, well-groomed, clean-cut. Very much looking like a very prosperous, you know, upper-middle-class person or something. Well-fed. No troubles, you know. No. And tremendous presence of energy and health and everything. So I said, wow, you are enjoying your retirement. You know, I was kind of worried, like, you retire for, you know, you got nothing to do, I'm not going to be happy. No, very happy. Retired from all problems, except the continuity problem. Retired from all idolatry. He said, hey, it's wonderful. It's wonderful. Don't be worried about it. It's great. Okay, so this is another wonderful video I've been able to do. And hopefully it will bring some help to people everywhere. Testimony. It's testimony. What I'm doing is I'm giving testimony. I'm witnessing testimony. That's what, you know, that's what I do. Because I have been through the fire. I know exactly what it's about. And you want to get free of that as soon as possible. Because it's a misadventure, really. It's the one adventure that's a misadventure. Trying to destroy yourself bring eternal death upon yourself is a misadventure for sure. And so you want to really put that in your rearview mirror for good. We all do. And that's what I'm all about. That's what I'll continue to be all about. Okay? So take it one day at a time and see what comes up as far as breakthroughs for you on this day. All right? Very great. Thanks for watching. That's it for this one.